The views expressed on this program are not necessarily the views of Lexington Community Radio or its board of directors. The views expressed are solely those of the programmers.
You are listening to Off the Cuff. Now, here's your host, Adam Banks.
Welcome, everybody, to Off the Cuff. I am Adam Banks coming at you live from Lexington, Kentucky. Thank you for listening to the show, and thank you for tuning in to WLXU 93.9 FM. In addition to listening to us on the radio, you can check out our Facebook live stream at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks, or you can download the Radio Lex app on your smartphone device to listen to us anywhere in the entire world. Amber Turner and I are both broadcasting from the Deborah Hensley Studios here at Radio Lex on North Limestone. Amber, it is April the 1st, 2021. Mm-hmm. Are you an April Fool?
I am not an April Fool. I do not appreciate this day, and this is not an April Fool's joke, but I'm having some problems with my headphones.
What kind of problems?
Like some problems like I can't hear out of one ear.
Well, let me tell you something. I hate this date as well. I'm not a big April Fool's Day fan. I think that it's silly because you can't believe anybody on this day.
Yeah.
You can't trust anybody. Anything anybody says, you think it's just a big joke. It's a big lie. So it really frustrates me because I'm not a fan of liars.
Yeah.
I don't like when people lie to me.
Even if it's a joke.
Even if it's a joke.
Like a funny ha-ha joke, like you laugh too.
It just depends on the practical joke.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So you're not a fan of the day either?
You know, just as I've gotten older, no, because we're just a little too grown for that. Like if people tell me some of the things that they used to tell me when we were younger, like I would probably be terrified now. Like, you're getting divorced? No! You're getting married? No!
Yes, because people kind of cross the line sometimes.
Yeah.
With their practical jokes.
They make them personal.
Like, I'm pregnant!
That ain't cool.
And that ain't cool because you don't know who's having problems getting pregnant.
Yeah.
And you're crossing the line a lot of the times. Or, we're getting a divorce.
Yeah.
And then, you know, sometimes you could say stuff and people could be like, oh, me too, but I didn't want to tell nobody until, but now I feel comfortable. And they're like, well, I was just joking. I'm not getting a divorce.
Well, and you wheel that stuff out into the universe when you say stuff like that.
You do. But so I started looking at the history of April Fool's Day, and I wondered, where does this day even come from?
Yeah.
It's been celebrated for several centuries by different cultures, and its exact origin still remains a mystery. It says that some historians speculate that April Fool's Day dates back to 1582 when France switched from the Julian calendar to the Gregorian calendar, as called for the Council of Trent in 1563. So they're saying that people who were slow to get to the news or failed to recognize that the start of the new year had moved to January 1st and continued to celebrate it during the last week of March through April 1st became the butt of the jokes and hoaxes. So that is kind of why we have April Fool's Day. It's always weird, isn't it, how holidays originate?
Yes, because it's nothing like it, like what we've turned it into.
Right. It's nothing like what we've turned it into. It's
why do we take everything too far?
We do. We have to, as Americans, we always have to turn something, we have to always make days out of something. And even more now, there's National Cheeseburger Day. There's,
I can get down with that day, though.
Yeah, take your best friend out for ice cream day. There's all kinds of days out there on the calendar. But it also listed some of the best April Fool's jokes to play on someone. Now, I'm not a fan of joking or playing a joke on somebody on April Fool's Day, but
noted.
Reading through some of these, they made me laugh. And I think that these would be pretty funny April Fool's jokes to do to people.
Okay.
So one thing you could do to somebody on April Fool's Day, which is today, if you haven't got them yet and you want to get them, you could fill up the room full of nothing but balloons.
Okay.
And it would make it really frustrating for them to walk around. You could fill up their car. I think that would be hilarious.
I did that before.
Okay. What was their response?
So I did it for a guy that I liked. And what ended up happening was the girl that helped me decided to jump into them like a ball pit. And she blacked her eye. She hit the wall and blacked her whole eye.
You could cover up the sensor of the remote control just as a
that
little...
That would cause World War III at my house.
As a little pet peeve. You could always put scary silhouettes, those little spiders and snakes. Mm-hmm. Man, those rubber snakes, if anybody, if you want to get me, I'll tell you how to get me. Put a rubber snake somewhere, and that would get me, because I hate snakes.
I know.
And any type of rubber snake, I'm running for the hills.
Well, you know, if you see a snake at my house, it is not rubber.
Well, that's true. You have a snake problem at your house. You could put confetti on the fan, and when somebody turns the fan on, it could blow everywhere. When I was little, me and my sister used to put books on top of the fan.
Why?
Because when my mom would turn on the fan, the books would go everywhere.
Uh-huh.
I'm surprised she didn't get hurt.
I'm surprised y'all didn't get whooped a lot.
Right. You could put a sign on somebody's car that says honk and smile. So every time somebody goes by them, they're going to be honking and smiling at them. So people are going to be wondering, why is everybody being so flirtatious with me today?
I would not take it that way, though.
It says here that you could play a joke on somebody using a chocolate or peanut butter bar and smear it in a diaper to make it appear dirty.
That's gross.
It is gross. You could, I thought this was funny, you could put bubble wrap under a rug, and when people step on the rug, it just starts popping. And how funny would that be to do that first thing in the morning? Because, you know, before caffeine and when you first wake up, you don't want to hear loud popping noises.
Well, and you're groggy, so, like, you're not going to think this is, I'm stepping on bubble wrap.
You're like, hey, oh, hey, oh, hey. As you jump up and down with the bubble wrap. But I thought that was funny. And then you could do this thing called rubber band barrier, where you tie rubber bands around a phone or a remote control, and you have to watch them just undo it. They say that's just funny, watching people just get 1,000 rubber bands off something.
There's nothing funny about that. People are cruel.
But yes, there has been times, Amber, that April Fool's jokes have gone wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And the site that I was looking at listed some of the April Fool's jokes over the years that have went wrong.
Okay.
People think that it's all fun and games, but sometimes when you're playing jokes on somebody, things can go wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So it's always hilarious until something goes wrong. But on April 1st, 1992, a man claiming to be Richard Nixon told NPR that he would be running for president and that he never did anything wrong. And despite that not being Nixon, everybody believed it. And people thought that Richard Nixon actually announced his presidency again.
Oh, my word.
Burger King announced a left-handed Whopper, which is silly, because there's no such thing as a right-handed or left-handed Whopper.
That's what you think.
Yes. That happened in 1998, and the joke was on the people, obviously, because their Whopper burger sales went out the roof. People were asking for left-handed burgers.
Left-handed Whoppers.
Left-handed Whoppers, and the employees were probably internally laughing to themselves.
They were probably, like, internally hating themselves, because they probably had to see a lot of people that day asking for a left-handed Whopper.
Let's see. In 2001, a DJ in England decided to prank his listeners on April Fool's Day by broadcasting that a ship that looked like the Titanic could be seen from the cliffs at Beachy Head in East Sussex. And hundreds of listeners believed him, and they all went to the cliffs to get a glimpse.
Mm-hmm.
But the foot traffic caused the cliff to fall just a couple of days later. So if it had been, you know, if it would have failed with all these people on it, that could have been a joke that went really, really wrong.
Wow.
Here's another one here. On April 1st, 2002, a couple of Kansas City DJs announced the local water supply had been found to contain high levels of dehydrogen monoxide, DHMO, whose side effects including sweating, urination, and skin pruning. So hundreds of citizens flooded the water department and the police with distress phone calls.
Wow.
But DHMO is actually H2O, the chemical name for water. So the DJs were just changing the name up. So they just made everybody go panic for nothing.
Uh-huh.
And they got highly criticized, and the DJs were pulled from the station.
I don't blame them on that one.
Yes. And finally, just one more here. A newspaper in Jordan ran an April 1st, 2010 article claiming a UFO had landed near the town of Jafar.
Mm-hmm.
The mayor of Jafar's response was to evacuate 13,000 people. Facing a potential lawsuit, the newspaper staff apologized publicly, saying, "We meant to entertain, not scare people." So
if you tell me a UFO has landed near my house, do you think I'm going to be happy about that? Or do you think I'm going to want to, like, run away from my house so fast? Like, what were they thinking? Come on.
Oh, here's some more here I didn't even know I had. In 2016, Google, as an April Fool's prank, added a button called the mic drop button. And it was, you could click that button on April Fool's Day, uh-huh. and it would not allow a person to respond back to you because you dropped the mic. You're done.
Wow.
So there were tons of people uh-huh. that were accidentally hitting this button because they didn't know what it meant.
Yeah.
And they were sending it to their bosses and
oh,
people that really mattered.
Wow.
And it caused a lot of uproar. And Google was actually sued by some people who lost their jobs over it.
Oh, well.
Yeah. Yeah. And here's another one. On April Fool's Day in 2013, an 18-year-old Tori Wheeler of Tulsa, Oklahoma, pranked her boyfriend Derek Bauer by pretending she was pregnant.
Uh-huh.
Here we go with one of these. Well, Wheeler, upset that Bauer didn't find her prank as funny as she hoped, she ended up pulling a knife on him, and the police ended up having to settle the matter. So she later said the knife was yet another prank, though.
Well, I don't rightly think threatening bodily harm should ever be considered a prank.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah.
And now
she
this
missed the mark twice that day.
And this really is the last one here. In 2013, Susan Tammy Hudson of Kingsport, Tennessee, called her sister on April Fool's Day saying, "I shot my husband. I'm cleaning up the mess. Let's go bury him in the black water." Though Hudson may have thought she was being funny, no one else did, and soon the police showed up. No charges were pressed after Hudson's husband arrived home alive and well, but that just goes to show you that you, even your sister's going to sell you out if you,
because
her sister straight up sold her out and called
sold
the law.
Sold her out?
Yeah.
Woo.
Right.
Her sister never listened to Earl Gotta Die.
By the Dixie Chicks.
By the Dixie Chicks.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a quick break. We got lots more Off the Cuff coming at you live after these words. Stick with us. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, through thee, how great thou art. Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Amber is also in studio with me. This song, How Great Thou Art, sang by Carrie Underwood. I'm telling you, if you have ever heard her sing this live with Vince Gill,
mm-hmm.
you can hear the Holy Spirit in her voice.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Beautiful song.
Touched. The Lord God Almighty himself was touched. Allowing her to sing those lyrics as beautifully as she did live that day.
Yeah.
A beautiful song. Amber, this Sunday is Easter.
This Sunday is Easter.
This Sunday is Easter. And, you know, I was going to start off this segment coming into a video that's been circling around. And it was by Lil Nas X.
Mm.
The song is called Montero, Call Me By Your Name. So I was going to start the segment with that song,
mm-hmm.
but the Holy Spirit jumped in and said, no, don't play that. So I thought I'd play this. What a song.
Beautiful song.
Don't that put chill bumps in your arms?
Yes, it does.
Lil Nas released a song called Montero, Call Me By Your Name. It was released last Friday when it became an instant ascent toward the top of YouTube's trending chart. Have you got a chance to watch the video?
I am personally opting and choosing to not watch the video. So I am so thankful you did not play that.
I didn't want to put it out there in the world any more than what it is.
Mm-hmm.
I saw the video. I've never seen anything more blasphemous in my entire life. Lil Nas slides down some type of pole to hell.
Mm-hmm.
And give Satan a lap dance.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently after the lap dance, Satan is mesmerized. And Lil Nas snaps his neck and then takes Satan's crown
mm-hmm.
and then puts it on his head. And now he is the new leader of the underground, the new leader of hell. I saw that and I said, I can't believe what I just saw. And I showed my dad because I just showed my dad everything like that. And my dad,
I am so curious
I'm
as to
sorry.
What he had to say
I'm
about that.
I'm sorry, Dad, for showing that to you. Because my dad, when I show him videos, he pulls them up on the big screen on TV.
Oh, man.
So in his house, just imagine Lil Nas giving Satan a lap dance.
Oh, right. That sounds like the setup of a very bad joke.
Very bad, yes. And it wasn't. So I apologize for making him sit through that because he said he felt like that he needed to pray over the house now.
Yes.
But it was a very blasphemous song. Not a fan of it at all. Anybody who says they are a fan of it, I think you need to do some self-evaluation of yourself because that's evil. It was pure evil. And not only has he released this video, but he's come out with these shoes. And he created these limited edition line of shoes, and he's calling these Satan shoes. And each shoe is containing a drop of human blood in the sole. Okay? And in the sole of the shoe, he's saying that it's human blood. I don't know whose blood it is. Is it Lil Nas's blood?
It don't matter whose blood it is.
But the thing is like, who's going to break that blood open to see if it's really blood?
Hey, it could be the blood of Jimmy Hoffa that tells me exactly where that man's buried at, and I still would not pay what this man wants for these shoes just because they got blood in them.
Yes. What's he wanting for the shoes? Do you know the price?
It's way too much.
So they are Air Max 97s made by Nike, and Nike is fit to tie over this.
Yeah, I don't blame them.
Yes, they're saying they have nothing to do with it. Lil Nas just bought 666 pairs of shoes.
Wow.
To sell.
Original.
Yeah, how original. The number of the beast, 666.
Yeah.
And he's out here buying 666 pairs of shoes to sell. So the company is saying they have nothing to do with this. They're not endorsing it. I hope that Nike wins this lawsuit and sues him for everything he has.
And shuts him down finally.
But, you know, and people, it's interesting. We talked about people in the music industry a couple weeks ago selling their soul. And the episode in the archives you can listen to, it's called Play It Backwards. And I think that, you know, you got to think Lucifer was the song leader in heaven. The devil knows music.
Yep.
So I think the devil likes to speak through music. And if Lil Nas hasn't sold his soul, if there is no better picture of selling your soul than what's in that video that Lil Nas X made, I don't know what else is. What does people think selling your soul is? Do they think it's actually just calling the devil on the phone and saying, hey, I'm ready to sell my soul? No, doing things like that, Lil Nas X, is what you call selling your soul to Satan.
Oh, yeah.
And you're over here doing that, man. And it just so happens to be the week of Easter, right? The week of Easter.
How convenient.
Yes.
How convenient.
How convenient. But Easter, it is this Sunday. And it's, you know, Christian theology teaches us that Christ's death is the perfect atoning sacrifice for all the sins of mankind. So the whole point of Jesus Christ, the whole point of him even existing, was to save men. We, when we were born in this world, we were, because of Adam and Eve and because of sin, we were doomed to all die and pay for our sin. And that horrible place that we were supposed to go to pay for our sin is hell. But because God's love for man, he became manifested in the flesh and became Jesus Christ, meant God manifested in the flesh and died for our sins on the cross to save mankind from their sins. And that's what this weekend is all about, to celebrate the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, because not only did he die because of his resurrection, it proves that he does live and we all can have eternal life in him. So I would like to talk about the crucifixion. We've not really talked about the crucifixion that much.
Yeah.
And I do want to talk about the crucifixion. And I think it's also a good segment for me to tell the audience my testimony and talk to everybody about my Christian faith, because I've never got to do that on Off the Cuff.
Yeah.
Not really flat out tell everybody my testimony. If you are a listener to this show, you know that I do believe in Jesus Christ. I am a saved man. But I've never really got to share my testimony. I grew up in a Christian home, and my dad was a preacher. And but because of that, that allowed me to be introduced to biblical studies very early, learn about Jesus, learn the way, learn the truth. But when I was 11 years old, I made a profession of faith, and I came to the Lord Jesus Christ, and I asked him to save me, and mm-hmm. I asked him to forgive me of my past, present, future sins. And when you get saved as a young child, I think, mm-hmm. I'm speaking for myself, I struggled throughout my life mm-hmm. with the assurance of salvation because there was really no dramatic change mm-hmm. in me from being a bad person to a good person because I was saved at such a young age. Mm-hmm. But as I got older and my biblical knowledge, of course, broadened throughout the years, I came to an understanding of being assured of your salvation. And I've worked that out with God throughout just my Christian life. So I hope, and my hope is that mankind can see that same gift that I see.
Yeah.
So I want to talk about the crucifixion. The crucifixion is the death of Jesus Christ. And they used to crucify people back in those days.
Yes.
You know, before they used to stone people. Sometimes back in a certain era, they used to burn people at the stake.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in Jesus's days, they used to crucify people,
mm-hmm.
hang them on a cross, and beat them. That's how they took care of people's punishment. Like
yep.
if you stole from people, if you murdered anybody, if you were just a bad person, you got hung on the cross and mm-hmm. you were crucified. But Jesus did nothing wrong. Jesus did nothing wrong, and he was still put to death. What they were saying he did wrong was he was being blasphemous because he was claiming to be God.
Yes.
So when they hung him on the cross, they beat on him, they mocked him, they spit on him, they put a crown of thorns on his head, they stripped him of his clothes, they beat him beyond the recognition of a man. It just looked like there was a piece of meat up there.
Yeah.
They treated him worse than they hung anybody on the cross. They mm-hmm. beat him worse than they ever beat anybody on the cross. And after that crucifixion, and, you know, he hung on the cross after they beat him for a good 6-7 hours. I don't know the exact time that he hung on the cross, but some theologists say it was from 9 in the morning to 3 p.m.
Wow.
So during that time, Jesus cast lots for, during that time, soldiers cast lots of Jesus' clothing while people passed by shouting insults at him.
Mm-hmm.
And while he was on the cross, you know, he talked to people. He talked to his disciple John. He talked to Mary while he was on the cross. And he also cried out to God and he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? And eventually he gave up the ghost and he died. But I want to talk about a certain moment that happened on the cross. Are you familiar with the story of Jesus in the middle, and on the two sides of him were two thieves?
So, as you know, I have just started reading the Bible, and I am actually at this part. So I think I read just a little bit that it touches about it, I think, in the book of Mark.
Mm-hmm.
That's the brief amount that I've gotten.
Yeah, I want to talk about the two thieves, because the story there of those two thieves was you had one, they both did the same thing. They mm-hmm. were just thieves. They were just bad people.
Yeah.
And they knew that they deserved to be on the cross. But one thief was saying that they all deserve to be there, but the other thief was saying that we deserve to be here, but not this man, not Jesus. And he looked at Jesus and he said, "Lord, remember me when you enter your kingdom." And Jesus looked at him and said, "Today, my son, you will be with me in paradise." So he was saving people while dying on the cross.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, what was interesting is, you know, people want to say all the time, you know, you got to go through the Pope, you got to go through the priest, you got to go through this, you got to go through that, you got to go. That thief looked right at Jesus Christ. There was no mediator.
No.
There was nobody he went through other than Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to play a clip for you. The clip that I'm going to play comes from a man named Dr. Peter Ruckman. It's always a good day to play. It's always a good day when you can play Dr. Peter Ruckman on the show. He's one of the smartest theologists I've ever met. He's passed away, unfortunately, now, but a lot of his messages come from the 80s. And one of the clips that I want to play to you today is talking about the salvation of Jesus and talking about how it's individual. It's for you. It's not for—just listen at the clip.
The gospel is for an individual who's dying and going to face judgment. Has nothing to do with schools and churches and people and sacraments and religions and popes and Marys and good works. It's a man dying, hitting judgment. That's who the good news is for. And look at there in that passage, verse 42. That's that dying thief talking to Jesus Christ. And what does he say? He says to him, he turns to Jesus and he says, Lord, he says, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. Now that's the right kind of talk. That's the right response. That's the prayer for salvation. All this stuff of Christ came to set society.
I mean, Lord, remember me. I mean, that's people make salvation so hard.
Yes, they make it something that's so unachievable.
Okay, now listen to the next clip.
That prayer is for individual salvation. All right, finally, look at the response, verse 43. Look at the response, verse 43. Notice in the response, there are no intermediates. No intermediates. Verily, verily, I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. You don't go through anybody. There are no intermediates. Mary's right there. Christ doesn't say one word to her about that fellow's salvation. And that fellow don't pray to Mary. Would you tell me something? Would you tell me why it is a dying thief in the first century has more theological understanding than a Roman Catholic pope? Here's some pope up there saying, oh, Mary, Mother of God, pray for us now, the hour of death. That thief is dying and Mary's right there. And he never said boo to her. He said, hey there, Mary, how you? Why, she's right there at the cross. If that dying thief was as smart as the Kennedy family, he would say, well, the easiest way to the Savior's heart is through his mother. Mary, would you intercede for me? Get out of here, Mary. You're standing in the way.
Get out of here, Mary. You're standing in the way, because the only way to God the Father is through Jesus Christ. Let's celebrate him this Sunday, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back after these words. Back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Amber is also in studio with me. Got into some heavy stuff there on the last segment, but I think that sometimes we talk about all kinds of nonsense on here, a lot of silly things. I was getting down to some serious business there on the last segment, and I think it was just something important I thought our listeners should hear.
Well, you know, you said something, and quite often you say a lot of things, and you know when you talk, I listen. And guys, I do listen when he talks, because so far he's not really been wrong in the advice that you give me. And you know, you were talking about how you struggled, you know, since you were baptized at a young age, you know, to refind your faith and keep your faith with reassurance. And, you know, I was also baptized at 11. We were both 11. So that was, I wanted to tell you that. I took that message to heart. And that was a reassurance to me because, you know, I have been trying to get back into my faith. So thank you for sharing that.
I'm glad I could put some perspective on there. But yes, I left the last segment with a somber story of Jesus dying, but because he lives and he resurrected on the third day is now the reason we can have eternal life. So thank God for that. Ladies and gentlemen, there is a, you know, I've been going back and forth with this whole vaccine. And, well, we've talked about the vaccine several times on the show.
Yeah.
And we talked about the three vaccines that currently exist right now in America. And we know that all three of the vaccines are not 100% FDA approved.
Mm-hmm.
And I struggle with getting it because I'm not sure about it. Anything that's not 100% FDA approved kind of freaks me out. It's in clinical trials. But I was wondering, are they going to start requiring this? Are they going to make people start to get this?
Mm-hmm.
Well, Rutgers University, and this hit home for me because, you know, I am a college professor, and this is something that it just hit home. They are now going to require their in-person students to get the COVID-19 vaccine if they want to be an on-campus student there.
Mm-hmm.
So they are among the first colleges to say that. And the news comes as New York State launched the nation's first vaccine passport. So they're saying that at Rutgers, students can seek a religious or medical exemption from the vaccine requirement, and students participating in fully online does not have to abide by that mandate. But mm-hmm. if you want to go in person, you have to. What do you think about the requiring of the vaccine?
This is not new news at all. You know, the schooling system have always required that students be immunized before coming in. If you remember, you know, I think the sixth grade was the last big time we got a lot of boosters. And you were very correct in saying that students can opt with theological views or with personal value views. Again, though, it's not really something that's new. I think that just because people are, you know, just like you said, it's not 100% FDA approved. I think that puts a little bit of leeriness in people. But this is a common practice that we have always done. I don't know that it has ever, like, been something that a university mm-hmm. has said. But, you know, usually by the time you reach a university level, mm-hmm. you've already had your past immunization. So I think it's just because we're in uncharted territories. But this is not anything new, no.
So other vaccines have been previously required by colleges and other schools for vaccines. Measles, mm-hmm. rubella.
You usually get those, though, when you're younger.
But the difference between those vaccines is they had the full 100% approval of the FDA. These vaccines, these COVID-19 vaccines, are only, what, 75, 80% approved, if that? So requiring something that's not 100% FDA approved, I have a problem with. I could see a requirement on something if it was 100% FDA approved by our government.
So are they saying that it is a requirement like now if you are want to continue in-person classes, or is this something that they're going to require for the fall? If so, I'm sure there's probably an anticipation that we will be 100% cleared by the FDA maybe by then, or at least closer.
Yeah, but it's just, you know, I can't get behind the whole 100% or the whole vaccine requirement when it's not 100% FDA approved. I just can't. What's campus life going to look like at Rutgers now? It's forever going to be changed because you know it's going to hurt their numbers.
I don't know.
Or you think more people are just getting the vaccine?
I do think that just more people are getting the vaccine. You know, Lexington has graciously started opening up and allowing different phases to come in. So I think we've got, what, like 50-some percent, or there's so, you know, X amount of people in Kentucky have been vaccinated. I don't think it's going to help or hurt. I think that's just one of those other nuances. Eventually, it's eventually just going to be one of those nuances you just got to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure, you know, I don't know how long that will last.
Rutgers.
Maybe that's just going to be something to get us through, you know, this initial year after or post-pandemic.
Rutgers won't be the only one to require this. There's going to be more colleges to do this, but there are different rights that students have versus employees have. Employees have more rights than students because employees, they have unions and different things that employees can have as their rights. So it would be more likely for the students to be made to get the vaccine before the employees, but eventually it could be everybody having to get it. So I don't know. I just, requiring something to be put in my body that's not been 100% approved, I can't get behind that. I can't get this out of my head either, and I can't remember the guy who it was that said it, but I ran across a video of a man who worked on a ton of vaccines
mm-hmm.
in the past, successful vaccines that are still used today, and he's come out against the COVID-19 vaccine saying that it is bad and that we're all screwed in America now because eventually so many people are going to get sick because the COVID-19 vaccine makes your body only focus on trying to look for COVID mm-hmm. and nothing else, allowing other viruses to attack your body. Now, just so you know at home, folks, I am no doctor. Please don't take my medical advice. I'm just talking about the hearsay that I am saying. So requiring something like that if true, if it really is only looking for COVID, I mean, we are screwed.
Well, I'm just going to say, for all information regarding the vaccine, just always make sure, you know, you can get information at the cdc.gov. Or is it cdc.gov? Or is it... Oh, my goodness. I don't know the CDC. Maybe it's .org.
It probably is cdc.gov. But, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take Off the Cuff's Song of the Week. And because of I feel in a very religious mood, let's play a little Alabama, Because He Lives. We'll be right back after the song.
All fear is gone. I can feel.
Whatever happened to Alabama? Are they still around doing music?
I'm sure they are.
Such a good band, a classy band.
My papa loved them.
They have the Alabama Theater in Myrtle Beach. Have you ever been to that?
I have not.
It's fun.
What do they do with Alabama
Theater?
Well,
they just have different people come in and sing, and sometimes Alabama themselves will come in and sing, but it's just decorated with a bunch of Alabama memorabilia.
Okay.
Yeah, it's in Myrtle Beach.
That's cool.
The Alabama Theater.
Well, that sounds a lot cooler than the Willie Nelson corner at the Texas Roadhouse.
So, Amber, the high school Sweet 16 tournament here in Kentucky has been happening.
Mm-hmm.
And I got to go watch our old high school, Knott County Central, play. They actually opened up the tournament.
Wow.
Yes, they opened up the tournament, and Knott Central played Elizabethtown, who, let me tell you something.
Mm-hmm.
Elizabethtown, they might be my favorite to win the whole thing.
Well,
yes, they're very good. Now I say that, I say that, and I haven't checked out any of the games today, so they might have lost. But from what I seen yesterday when I watched them play Knott County Central, they were good.
Yeah,
they were so good. But I made some observations at the game that I want to talk about.
Okay,
number one, and I've always wondered this. It wasn't just at the Sweet 16 tournament that I saw this, but I saw it a lot at the Sweet 16, so it reminded me.
Yeah.
Why is it that coaches feel the need to pat players on the butt when they're sending them into the game?
I don't know. That bothers me. It always has bothered me.
It does me too. Why pat players on the butt?
Yeah, don't touch my privates.
Are we still doing that in 2021?
I hope we're not.
I hope we're not either, because I find it very disturbing when a coach is like, good game, and he gives a pat on the butt.
Yeah, pat me on the back, on the shoulder blade or something.
Right.
No, my rump run.
I always thought it was odd when I seen even a person in sports just slap a guy's butt and say, good game, and slap their butt.
Yeah, don't do that.
But they do. And people in sports, they do that a lot. Like, what would be really awkward is if you were in the locker room and you were getting dressed and you were naked.
Aww.
And somebody came up to your wet butt and just slapped it and said, good game, man.
And we'd be a fist fighting.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So I saw a lot of butt slapping at the Sweet 16.
Oh, wait, it is still happening in 2021?
Well, I seen it. It reminded me. But, like, why are we still doing that in 2021?
I don't know.
It don't need to be happening.
Uh-uh.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of the butt slapping. Never was, but I saw it a lot growing up. You know,
I wonder if Akon wrote that song about that.
Yeah. And another thing that I just find completely just crazy that I saw at the Sweet 16, you know, they're not allowing players to jump for the ball at the start of the game. You know how you have to tip for the ball?
Yeah.
So, apparently, the president of the KHSAA, or whatever this is, high school, Sweet 16 stuff, he's saying that that's deemed unsafe in his eyes. That it's just unsafe for two guys to tip for the ball. However, those same two guys that you made flip a coin for the ball is going to be rubbing all over each other with their sweaty bodies playing defense and offense.
Yeah.
So, makes zero sense. Dude, where's the logic in that?
So, are they saying that it is not safe because of COVID-19 restrictions that they don't do the tip-off normally?
Yes. Yes.
That don't make no sense.
It makes no sense. So, why? And plus, I'm a big fan of just tipping for the ball. You know, every game has to start some way.
Yeah.
Every game's got to start some way. And basketball is unique because you jump for it.
Yeah.
And they took that away, and you got to flip a coin now. And but why can't you jump, but you can do other things in a basketball game? That seems to be more invasive than just tipping for the ball.
I don't know about that one.
But from the games that were yesterday, there was no upsets. Elizabethtown 87, Knott Central 59, Bowling Green 85, University Heights 57, Ballard 70, Madison Central 61, George Rogers Clark 54, Odom County 47. George Rogers Clark.
Hey!
Yeah, shout out to my next door neighbor, Josh Cook, who I grew up with, who I, his house was a couple miles from, I say a couple miles, it actually probably was a half a mile from my house. And we grew up in the same area. So it's funny when I say some of these things in the holler that we both grew up in, he's going to know exactly what I'm talking about. But Josh grew up to become a basketball coach, and he coaches George Rogers Clark. And now he's back in, I believe this is his third Sweet 16 tournament.
Hey.
So good luck to Josh, man, a good old Knott County boy.
Well, good luck, Josh. I don't know ye, but good luck.
Yes. But ladies and gentlemen, stick with us. We got one more segment to go right here on Off the Cuff. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Last segment of the hour. Amber Turner is also in studio with me. March Madness is in full swing. We've already had rounds one, rounds two. We've already had the Sweet 16. We've already had the Elite Eight. Amber, we are now only down to four teams. We have a final four here in the NCAA Men's Basketball Tournament.
And I didn't pick not a one of them to be in my final four. My bracket's a bust.
We only have four teams left. They are Gonzaga, UCLA, Baylor, and Houston. I think that it's the four most I don't want to say the four most unlikely, but if you would have asked me at the start of the season who was going to be in the Final Four, I would not have said any of those.
Yeah.
Gonzaga, though, chasing a perfect season. If they win out and they win it all, they're the first team since Indiana, since the 70s, to go undefeated all year.
Wow.
Yes. UCLA hasn't been to a Final Four since 2008.
Okay.
You know, and if they win again, that's their 12th championship.
That's cool.
12th. They've already got the most of anybody else with 11, so this is just going to stack on to their numbers. Baylor's not won since the 50s, if they have ever won, but they've not been to the Final Four since the 50s.
Wow.
Yes, and then Houston, I just still can't believe they're there.
They probably can't believe they're there.
But yeah, the bracket, the off-the-cuff bracket challenge, it's been really fun. Thank you guys for those who participated in it. You can still keep track of your bracket by going to Off the Cuff's Facebook page and clicking on it. You can see the rankings and the leaderboard. I try to update after every round. But Off the Cuff has been airing a special entitled the March Madness Series, which covers nothing but the March Madness Tournament. The March Madness Series will continue tonight at 8 o'clock to discuss what all happened during the Sweet 16 and the Elite Eight games. So you can catch that right here on WLXU 93.9, and it will also be available right after the broadcast on podcast. So double the trouble again today of Off the Cuff. You had Off the Cuff at 4, and now you have Off the Cuff again tonight at 8.
How are you not tired?
I'm exhausted.
Yeah.
But I love it. This is my fuel.
Mm-hmm.
This is how I cope. This is my relaxing time, too. But because we do such a whole series on March Madness, that's why we don't really discuss it a lot during the 4 o'clock hour.
Well, and I don't know just a whole lot about basketball.
Yes.
I don't.
But it will be a really good episode to check out if you are a basketball fan. And I hope that you can. But, ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you for listening to another episode of Off the Cuff. I want to remind you that you can listen to all of our previous episodes by going and subscribing to our podcast on iTunes, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever podcasts can be streamed. You can follow me on social media at The Adam Banks. You can follow the co-host on social media at Ambu447. You can follow Off the Cuff on Facebook and Instagram at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. We put out new episodes every Thursday from 4 to 5 right here on WLXU 93.9. If you haven't downloaded the Radio Lex app, please do so, because you can stream the show and listen to us live. We're also on Facebook, and we're everywhere. But we're going to have to get out of here, ladies and gentlemen. That is Amber Turner. I'm Adam Banks. This is Off the Cuff. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
Enjoy it with your families. and celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We'll catch you down the road. We'll see you next Thursday from 4 to 5. But, hey, don't forget about the March Madness Series special at 8 o'clock tonight to talk about the tournament. We'll see you next week, and we'll see you tonight.